So in this video lecture, we will be learning about Clariflocculator. It is the treatment plant in which the clarification as well as the flocculation or flocculating of the particles takes place, and this comes into the sedimentation aided with coagulation. So let's start with it. Now the coagulation sedimentation plant is sometimes called as Clariflocculator. It has four parts. Part A is feeding device, Part B mixing device, Part C flocculation tank or flocculator, and Part D is settling tank or sedimentation tank. Now let us learn about each one by one. Part A, feeding device. Now we can do the feeding now what is this feeding device? Basically feeding of what? Feeding of coagulant, because sedimentation aided with coagulant is basically that we are adding coagulant to the water just so that the particles get flocculated and they get heavier or their size increases and the settlement is helped with that. So here we are talking about the feeding of coagulant. So there is dry feeding and then there is wet feeding. Now what is this dry feeding? In this we have a hopper kind of arrangement in which the coagulant is put as a powder, and you see this shaking. This is the agitation of the plates. The plates can be agitated. These two side plates that you can see, this one and this one, they both can be vibrated or they can be agitated so that this coagulant, which is in the powder form, can smoothly drop in. Next we have toothed wheel here. As you just saw its movement, it rotates basically, and whatever coagulant powder that falls down here, that is because of this rotation it goes to the raw water. So this is a rough way how this entire process works. The coagulant in the powdered form is filled in the hopper bottom. Agitating plates are provided to prevent the arching of the coagulant. Arching is basically you know that any powdered form, even the flour at our home, when it is kept for a very long time and some moisture gets collected, then it gets a little bit hardened. So it should not be settled there for a long time. Hence these agitating plates are there, which keeps the coagulant from moving, which keeps it moving and thus preventing the arching action. The dosage to the raw water is regulated or controlled by a tooth wheel or a helical screw. Now this tooth wheel or a helical screw, whenever we want this coagulant or in whatever quantity we want, this can be rotated, and then we can get the coagulant from there. Next we'll come to the wet feeding device. Now this is a little bit complicated in just looking, but very easy in understanding. Now first we'll see the whole setup. Okay, so this is not the whole setup, but just see. Now this is a tank in which the wet coagulant is stored. Wet coagulant meaning the coagulant is mixed with liquid, and it is basically in the liquid form. Okay, just like how you get some other products which you get in powdered form and some you get in liquid form, something like that. So here the coagulant is in liquid form and it is stored in this particular tank. Now this, you can see here a valve sort of thing. It's not a valve, but it's the level regulator. Now as and how the level of this coagulant rises, this ball is there which keeps on floating on the coagulant, and it can go up and down accordingly. So yeah, so now basically raw water is at the bottom, Now there's this arrangement which we'll see. There's this plug, as you can see there's a conical plug here, right? When this plug is raised, only then this coagulant can enter here. If the plug is at the bottom and it is closing the entire thing, the coagulant cannot enter the water. Only when this plug is raised, it can enter. Now, the special part about this plug is that if you raise it more, then more coagulant can enter here. So this plug not only stops the coagulant from going inside the water, but it can also act as a regulator that how much coagulant should go inside the water. Now this entire thing is actuated by, now just see, when that plug is raised, did you see the plug being raised? Just check it again. When the plug is raised, only then the coagulant gets mixed with the raw water. Now what happens if, suppose, the supply of your raw water increases. This is the supply of your raw water. Now if this supply of the raw water increases, obviously this dosage of coagulant won't be enough. We will need more dosage of coagulant, right? So at that time what happens when the supply of the raw water increases? Did you see here? When this level increased, this level also increased. You see it again. When this level increases, this level also increases, and there is again a floating ball or floating device which the level is changed. Now this floating device is attached to this pulley kind of a system. When this goes up, here the pulley is actuated, or the pulley rotates. Because of this, this pulley rotates and automatically this plug will also go up. So this plug will move up and more coagulant will start coming down. So this entire process is automatic, that when the raw water comes inside and this plug is raised up, this ball is raised up, it is connected to this pulley kind of system, and this pulley raises up this conical plug. So when this conical plug is raised, more coagulant is fed to the water. So in wet feeding, the coagulant is prepared as solution and is kept in a tank. The coagulant flow is maintained as per the raw water flow, and the level of coagulant is checked using an automated float. So this is that automated float, and this checks the level of coagulant inside the tank. If this is quite more, then we can stop the coagulant from coming in this tank, because it may cause overflow also, right? The inflow of coagulant in the raw water is controlled by a conical plug. So the flow of this coagulant inside the water is controlled by this conical plug. As the raw water supply increases, the level in float chamber also increases, which elevates the level of the float, which in turn initiates pulley mechanism, and the conical plug is lifted so as to allow more inflow of coagulant. So this is nothing but the same thing which I explained you previously. Let us move to part B, which is the mixing device or mixing basin. Now after you have put the coagulant inside your water, that coagulant has to be properly mixed inside the water, right? So first we allow that mixing through a mixing basin. This is the plan of that mixing basin, and here you can see I have drawn it in a 3D shape. So when the flow happens, it has to go through these walls, and automatically the coagulant is mixed. These walls are called as baffle walls. This is a horizontal type of flow. There is also a vertical type of flow in which the water will enter from here. So this is a vertical type of flow, and all these walls are called as baffle walls. So in this, our coagulant is mixed inside the water. Again, we also need something called as mixing device, in which it is mixed with paddles that we'll learn later on. So this is that mixing paddle which I was saying. It is called as mixing basin or a flash mixer. Mixing basin with a flash mixer. Now let us see how this works. The raw water that just came from those baffle walls, it goes from this end. There is something called as deflecting wall. And we have impeller shaft and impellers. Now what happens, see, when the raw water comes here, it is deflected by this wall and it has to go down. It has to go from here to fill it up. So it has to touch this impeller. Now these impellers are in constant motion and very fast motion, right? So because of this fast motion, the mixing basin is mixed with a flash, mixed very quickly, or with a flash mixer. Now before this, you can keep that mixing baffle walls which we just saw, or you can also directly put the raw water inside this mixing device or inside this mixing basin. So not necessarily you need to have that baffle wall type of arrangement, horizontal or vertical flow arrangement. Now I hope you understood how this is working. The inlet for raw water will come here. This deflecting wall will make sure that all your raw water comes in contact with this impeller so that it is mixed thoroughly and only it gets filled. Then this coagulant pipe is there which will give it constant coagulant supply, so that the coagulant is also supplied to the water and the mixing also takes simultaneously. And then from this part the water goes up, and it goes to the flocculation tank. The impeller speed is generally kept between 100 to 120 rpm. Now this is important as far as design problems related to this mixing basin is concerned. Detention period is generally half a minute to 2 minutes. The detention period is very less in this kind of mixing basin. Power required for flash mixer may vary from 2 to 5 kilowatts per cubic meter per minute. Our input in mixing and flocculation is frequently expressed in terms of temporal mean velocity gradient. This is something new, where g dash is equal to p upon mu v raised to half, or it is basically square root of p by mu v. Now what is p? G dash is velocity gradient. P is power dissipated in watts, that is newton meters per second. Mu is dynamic viscosity of water, and capital V is volume of water. Always remember, capital V is volume of water. Many times students get confused that is the velocity. It's basically volume, not to use the velocity. Now what is this G dash? G dash is nothing but the velocity gradient, that is the velocity of particle at this level to the velocity of particle at this level. If I have to draw a graph, let's say the velocity of particle at this level is this much and the velocity of particle at this level is this much, then the slope of this is nothing but your velocity gradient. Okay, so it is a difference between the velocities at this point and this point, or between any two points, you can see between any two points, between either this point or this point, the slope of the velocity is nothing but your velocity gradient. Okay. For rapid mixing, the product of G dash into T, which is now one thing that you need to see is velocity gradient. The second the units of velocity gradient are per second, that is G dash units are per second or second inverse, so or it is like 1 by second. So if you multiply this G dash with time, you will get a unitless quantity. And for rapid mixing, the product of G dash into T should be around 30,000 to 60,000, where T is the detention period or mixing period, usually 60 to 120 seconds. So for mixing basin, the detention time is around 1 minute to 2 minutes. If not even in the question, we can assume the detention time, or generally it is given in the numericals. Design steps. Detention time is T, which is 1 to 2 minutes if not given. Volume of mixing basin is V, which is Q into T. So you need to find the volume of mixing basin. Then depth of mixing basin, which if not given is assumed to be 1 to 1.5 meter. If generally they will give you the depth to the diameter or depth to any of the length, like ratio they will give, so from that you can find the depth. If not given, you can assume surface area of mixing basin is volume divided by height, obviously. So generally this mixing basin is kept circular or square in plan. So if you see the plan view of this mixing basin, it is generally circular or square. Assume G dash if not given or not asked to find. If it is not given and not even asked to find, and if you require in the calculation, then you can assume G dash to be 500 to 1000 per second in between range, that is 750 you can assume. Power P is G square into mu V. Now from where did this formula come? We just saw a formula for G dash, which was G dash is equal to root of P by mu V. This was a formula that we just saw. So obviously power will be G square into mu V. Power is also equal to half into CD rho W AB into V cube. Now what is this? These impellers, you see, these impellers will have blades here. They will be having blades which are going to cause the mixing. Okay, these blades are going to cause the mixing, not these impellers. Impellers are just like a shaft. So if I have to draw a 3D kind of view, it's quite difficult to draw it like this, but this is kind of blade and the impeller is just like this, and then there will be one more blade here like this. So there are four blades shown in this particular diagram. These blades are going to cause your mixing. Now this CD is called as drag coefficient, and rho W is obviously the density of water. AB is area of all the blades, okay, not one blade, area of all blades together. So if there are four blades, so you will be, it will be area of cross sectional area of four blades. And V cube, V is nothing but a relative velocity, relative distance. its relative velocity. And it is generally equal to 0.75 of blade velocity. The velocity of these blades, so 0.75 times velocity of blade is equal to your relative velocity. Now, why are we doing half CD rho WAB square? It is because whenever the blades are moving in any direction, let's say these are those blades, if they are moving like this, then only this area of your blade or this area is going to cause the mixing, or basically only this much area is, half the area of the blade is getting the drag. The other side is not getting the drag, the other, because the blade is something like this, right? So maybe only this part of the blade is getting the drag, the other side of the blade is not getting the drag. So this area is basically, in the formula, it is directly taken as half. So you don't have to do anything else for that. Okay. Impeller die to tank die is generally 0.2 to 0.4 times. The ratio is like that. Now, before moving to the next part we'll cover in the next video lecture. Before moving to the next part, how do we find this blade velocity? Now, this blade velocity, when this is rotating like this, the blade velocity is nothing but the angular velocity, and the angular velocity of this impeller is converted to its tangential component, and this VB is that tangential component. So that VB is given as R omega. Okay, so where R is nothing but the radius of this impeller, and omega is the frequency by which that impeller is rotating. So into 2 pi n by 60. This is how you will find VB. It is R omega, the tangential component of your angular velocity, and it is, the omega is given as 2 pi n by 60, where n is a frequency or n is a RPM by which the impeller is rotating. Next two parts, that is part C and part D, we will be doing in the next lecture. And after that, we will also be solving numericals.